All right, good afternoon.
I am Paul O'Grady from the Office of Student Affairs, and I will welcome all of you to our second Milbank Tweed Forum of the semester. We have an amazing panel assembled here today. How many of you are 1L students? Okay. We used to do this panel as part of 1L orientation, but we decided we needed grizzled law school veterans to be here. So you guys have some experience under your belt, and I hope you'll appreciate the panel talking about a life in the law today. I have two quick housekeeping announcements. Be aware that this event is being recorded for the law school website. And the next Milbank Tweed Forum, entitled The State of the Threat, moderated by Professor Sam Raskoff, will be Wednesday, October 5th, and we hope that you will all be able to make it. So now, without further ado, I turn it over to someone who does not need an introduction, Professor Arthur Miller.
It is an amazing array of talent. And some years ago, most of these people were sitting where you're sitting. Not all of them, but just most of them. What we're going to try and do is let these folks reveal themselves to you so that you get a sense of the tremendous variety of activities that can flow from a legal education. We have spent, I would say, at least 3 minutes preparing for this. And unlike certain civil procedure classes, no one here is prepared. But we'll see where we go. Jodi, can I ask you to ratchet your head back to when you entered law school? Not today, when you entered law school. What did you expect?
I expected to be worked very hard and to be prepared for a career as a prosecutor.
Why did you come into law school thinking that you would be an ace prosecutor? Did Marcia Clark enthrall you or something?
That was what I was, the area of law I was most interested in. I thought it would get me on my feet, and I would be gaining the kind of experience more quickly than in any other practice environment. And by the way, I never became a prosecutor.
Tell them what you did become.
Well, I went to a large New York law firm as a litigation associate, and I loved what I did. In fact, I've loved every career step that I've made. I've loved every job I've had, but I was also—
Can't you hold a job? What do you mean every job you've had?
Well, I was always very willing— I was very willing to reinvent myself at every stage in my career. And I decided after a number of years in a large law firm that what I really wanted to do is be in-house counsel at a sports organization. And so I started taking the steps and networking in the areas where I could hear about such jobs. And my next move was to spend a dozen years in-house counsel at the NFL.
A dozen years, 12 years. Now, how many sports law classes did you take? Here
zero.
At NYU.
Zero.
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 And how much sports law work did you do at Simpson Thatcher, which I believe was your law firm?
That's right. Well, actually, they had one sports law client, one, that happened to be a not-for-profit. So they had to assign the work for that client to as junior a level as they felt comfortable doing to keep the bills down. And I happened to be lucky enough to be assigned to that client and did. It wasn't. It was probably maybe 10% of the work I did over the 6 years I was at the firm, but it was just enough for me to convince somebody at the New York City Bar Association that I was qualified to become a member of a very exclusive club there, their sports law committee. And there I was working on projects for the sports law committee at the New York City Bar Association, whose membership included the in-house counsel for every single major sports league headquartered in New York.
So you were 12 years with the NFL?
Yes.
Why in heaven's name, would you ever leave that job? That's nirvana.
It is.
The ultimate.
It is absolutely nirvana, and including the fact that one of my responsibilities for the organization made it a requirement of my job that I attend every single Super Bowl. That's the job I want. So, yes.
But wait a second. The Super Bowl's on Sunday. That's not a work day.
Oh, it is. If it is, if you're a lawyer for the NFL.
And now what do you do?
And now I am an academic. And that's one of the reasons that I decided to leave the NFL, is as much fun as it was, as enjoyable and interesting as the work was, I felt it was getting me a little distant from one of the reasons I went to law school in the first place, was my love of the intellectual side of the law, of being a scholar, of keep learning new things. And to return to that, I decided I wanted to go into academia. And again, I had to reinvent myself. And that's what lawyers just need to be prepared to do, especially in today's economic climate. As a lawyer, wherever you are, you have to keep thinking about how you can expand your talents, your network, and what you might do next.
Now, what do you teach?
Right now, I teach at New York Law School. I actually see some of my students, former students here. I used to teach here. I teach at New York Law School their first year legal practice course, very much like NYU's lawyering course.
What else are you going to teach?
Probably sports law.
You know what I'm teaching this spring?
Sports law?
Yeah.
Can I come?
I'll make a deal. I'll teach it over there and you teach it here.
First, let me audit.
Nobody will notice.
Take
the
that
difference.
Deal.
Now, Brad, how about you?
Which question? Why I became a lawyer?
Let's take you back to your youth. When you entered this school, what did you think was going to become of you?
You know, that's such an embarrassing question. When I came here, and I don't think this is true of anyone anymore, and I don't think it was true of anyone then, but I had no idea that there was such a thing as big defense law firms. Cravats, Wayne & Moore, Simpson Thatcher, none of those names meant anything to me. I'd never heard them. My dad did intersection collisions, and I figured I'd go to law school and do intersection collisions representing plaintiffs.
Intersection? Is that international law word? You know, what the hell is intersection collision?
You know, slip and falls, a car going northbound, another car is going eastbound, there's a traffic light, somebody hits somebody else.
If I were to rephrase that, Brad, you thought you were going to be an ambulance chaser.
More or less.
I resent that, Arthur. Sorry. Frankly, that kind of law is just as important as the big firm law kinds of cases. As a matter of fact, to the people involved, more important.
And that's very
After
true.
After all, what's the big deal with the big
Defend
firms?
Me, Brad.
It's
she's
all
beating
about
the crap out of me.
I'm not going to defend you because she's 1,000% correct.
All right. So what in fact happened?
What in fact happened is, after clerking for a year, I became a big defense lawyer. In fact, I was at Simpson Thatcher along with Jodi, and was there for 7 years, I think. But over time, I really did go, if not to be an intersection collision lawyer, at least to be a plaintiff's lawyer. That's really what I always wanted to do. I did not particularly, I loved the people I worked with. Simpson Thatcher's a great firm, they do great work. Not a knock at them or defense firms, but I did not like the defense side of the practice for a whole lot of reasons. Maybe the easiest one is if you think of a lawsuit and the money involved, the best thing that can happen to you as a defendant's lawyer is not to lose money. The best thing that can happen to you in a trial proceeding is not to have your witness say something that's going to cost your client money. That's the opposite of being a plaintiff's lawyer. You can only go up as a plaintiff's lawyer. So I became a plaintiff's lawyer at a large securities class action firm then known as Milberg Weiss, now Milberg LLP. And I've been there ever since. We do not only securities class actions, but we do antitrust work, we do ERISA work, we do consumer class actions, we do QUITAM actions, which are increasingly important, which
You're
are
happy.
Whistleblower cases. I am happy, frustrated, but happy. As I was saying at lunch today, the law has really developed in a new direction, and we can talk later about Iqbal, Ball, and Twombly and all those cases, but at the end of the day, the current jurisprudence can be summarized as plaintiffs lose. So it's frustrating.
So Is it fair to say you followed your heart, your feelings, your attitudes, your philosophy?
I think so, and maybe even more so, because, you know, I did always want to be a plaintiff's lawyer, and I got to do it, and to do it in an area that was a whole lot more sophisticated than anything I ever imagined existed. I didn't know about class actions. Whoever heard of class actions?
And what about you? Didn't you become the prosecutor Jodi thought she was going to become?
I did, yes.
Why a prosecutor? You like to put people in jail?
Well, I came to law school having no idea what I would do. You know, I tell the story a lot that I was the only person in my criminal procedure class to take crim pro pass fail, because my professor accidentally had offered the 5-credit class pass fail. And of course, I sat in the back row of the class with 6 of my good friends, and everyone was taking it for a grade, and I kept saying, "What's wrong with you people? You'll never practice criminal law. No one practices criminal law." So I clearly did not think I would ever become a criminal prosecutor. And I regretted many times when I was a criminal prosecutor not having paid attention in criminal procedure. But I did pass, of course. But I then clerked for a judge who'd been a county prosecutor in New Jersey. And I spent a lot of time in federal court clerkship in the courtroom watching criminal cases. And I just fell in love with it. And I knew that it was the next job I wanted to take.
You think there are people in jail now who are in jail because you didn't take criminal procedure seriously?
I think that.
You think that. Annalisa?
As a former public defender, I think there are some people in jail where maybe not Anne was the prosecutor, but the prosecutors didn't learn the law and maybe violated a few people's rights.
How about the judge?
Thank you. Or the judge didn't study any criminal law and thinks they were running a civil trial, which is very different.
Did you become a public defender because of what? Because you believed they were underrepresented? Because you really believed they were innocent? Whereas she really believed they were guilty?
I don't know what she believed.
We have a Rashomon problem.
We're seated somewhat at a distance. No, I'm kidding. You know, I became a public defender because that's where my heart lies. I really fell in love with the clients who need help. And no, it had nothing to do with believing they're all innocent. In fact, to this day, I'm convinced they're not, but some are, and some in jail are. So I guess to answer your question, it's just I entered my first year summer internship from NYU, went down to New Orleans, where I'm from, and interned at the Juvenile Justice Project of Louisiana, interviewed some kids in jail, and wanted to get them out. So that's why I became a public defender.
Can I jump in on the prosecutor question? Because when I clerked, I loved being in the courtroom, and I knew I wanted to try cases. But there are obviously two sides. And so it's exciting no matter which side you're on. And it's also very important no matter which side you're on. I personally wanted to be a prosecutor because I wanted to be the one who got to make the case, right? I wanted it to be my responsibility to figure out what had happened, what the facts were, and whether someone was guilty or innocent or not. And in my career, I've always worked in offices and been lucky enough to run an office where if you didn't believe someone was guilty or there were significant issues in a case with proof, I was able to have the discretion to dismiss the case. So that's one of the things that drew me to being a prosecutor. But you know, I did actually think at the beginning about being a defense lawyer too.
But then you became a politico.
It's true.
Hmm?
It's true. Guilty.
What? Nothing wrong.
This is my lawyer.
I mean, Jonathan over here. You represented the Upper East Side. I have this sickening feeling that you were my assemblyman when I lived on the Upper East Side.
Did you vote for me?
As far as I can tell, the best thing I know about you, Jonathan, is that you did me no harm.
It's a low bar for people in office these days.
I'm not sure
the two
that.
Of you, politics. You come out of law school, you become a prosecutor.
I had been doing jobs in politics since I was 16, but after law school I clerked in Bismarck, North Dakota for a U.S. District Court judge, practiced law in Manhattan by New York standards, a medium-sized firm in litigation and labor and employment, but also was sort of going on a parallel track, joining the local community, being appointed to the local community board, becoming the Democratic State Party official for my district. So I was sort of going on two tracks, the partnership track in the law and the political track. Ran in 2002 for the first time, won, and that was the that was what I did for 9 years up until about 2 months ago.
Now, what in law school prepared you for any of this?
Nothing.
Nothing. So can we mark you down as someone
It gave me some future contributors, I guess.
Well, I was going to mark you down as someone who resents law school.
No, not at all. I think that for those who are considering a career in politics, there are two ways of doing about it. There's working for an elected official or developing a career in something else and then transitioning. I don't think there's a right way or a wrong way, but the way that I did it is the way that was best for me, because I knew I had a career to fall back on. I think the worst way to run for office is if you're running because that's how you're going to get health insurance. When you're running for office and have the stability of having a career to go back to if the election doesn't work out, I think is a much saner and calmer way to enter the political
lab. But you didn't go back to the law firm.
I did not.
What are you doing now?
Three months ago, met with the governor, and he said, well, anything I could do to have you come work for me, and we talked about a couple of things, and now I'm running the New York State Liquidation Bureau, which
Does that get rid of Republicans?
What's that?
The Liquidation Bureau, does it get rid of Republicans?
I have the most Republican district held by a Democrat. I very much appreciated my Republican constituency. I wouldn't have been in office without them. So, when an insurance company is in distress, we take it over and run it, and until either it's rehabilitated or it's liquidated. I have about 260 people working for me. We have about $3 billion in assets that we oversee, and about a budget of about $50 million each year.
Do you still have the political bug in you?
Pretty much it's gone. It's much easier to be an elected official before as a single person than as a married father. My priorities have changed.
That's a euphemism for saying you need more money.
That's part of it. I'm one of the few people who joined the executive branch in order to get a raise. I think that my priorities are different now. I had been gearing up to run for Congress a couple of years ago. The seat was going to be open, then ended up not being open. So that possibility has really sort of passed by. I really feel I went out on a high. I went out authoring about 35 laws over a 9-year period and doing a lot of good for the community. I really feel that end of my life is over, and now looking to develop a new area either in government or eventually back in law
You buy into Jody's notion that you have to reinvent yourself every once in a while?
Well, I've been, I guess, 16 years out of law school, and I'm on my fourth career, so I guess, yes, there is a reinvention that always takes place.
Let me go back to Anne. Anne, prosecutor, then, I call it politics. You worked with Senator Corzine, right?
Yes.
And then you became the Attorney General of New Jersey.
Yes.
Now, Jonathan is running an office with 260 people, which is an upper medium-sized law firm equivalency. What did you run when you were AG?
When I started in the AG's office, we were about 10,000 people, and we went through a series of budget cuts and ended up at about 9,200.
How do you manage 9,200 people?
It's a challenge. And you have a lot of very good leaders in charge of different divisions and units. And we had, the civil rights division, the civil law division, the criminal law division, the entire New Jersey State Police. We had oversight of all the county prosecutors and police officers. We had the gaming commission, so we oversaw mixed martial arts, consumer affairs. So you have to hire people who are fantastic to really help you run that type of agency.
And what law school prepared you for any of this?
I will tell you, I think I learned a couple things in law school that were incredibly helpful, but specifically nothing.
AG, you had to have a law degree.
Yes, and I argued cases myself. I defended the new school funding formula before the state Supreme Court, so you have to be a real lawyer. But I'll tell you a couple things. One is that the first day I was in law school, John Sexton told us to call everyone back the same day. And it turns out in your career, at least in my career, to have been one of the most helpful things I ever learned. So
It's something, you know, someone could tell you for free without spending $150,000 on law school, but it turned out to be a very, very helpful piece
you
of advice.
You paid tuition to have John Sexton tell you to return calls,
the
right?
The same day. Okay. You'll find a lot of people don't.
Does Ricky tell you to email everyone back, or?
It's your text.
Yes, you should do that.
And the other thing was, you know, I joke about this, but there's a lot of integrity. There's a lot that you learn about integrity and how important it is to, you know, practice honorably when you go through law school. And, you know, that, I think, helps a lot when you run a massive office with a lot of challenges and a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad I went to law school. I loved it.
Well, one of the things that amused me, in a sense, because I have a perverse sense of humor, is that throughout your entire life, you've been going back and forth across the Hudson River, New York, New Jersey, et cetera, et cetera.
And D.C.
Is Christie going to run? Oh, that's another matter. Bill.
So, Arthur, you asked the question, what were your expectations when you came to law school? I'll tell you a little story, or tell the students a little story, that give you an idea of what my expectations were. I was interested in economics as an undergraduate, and was impressed with a professor of economic history. He was just a brilliant older man, and I wanted to become a professor of economic history. So I signed up for the graduate record exams to go to graduate school in economics and in history. And the day before the examination, I went to a party that night, and I got completely drunk. And the next morning, when I was supposed to take the GRE, I slept until about 10:30. And I woke up, and the test was half over, and I thought, what am I going to do with my life now? This is true. And so the next exam was the law school admissions test. So I said, okay, I'll take that. I'm good with it. And so I had no expectations, and it's been a great profession for me, very challenging, very interesting. My overall is that life is something that happens to you while you're planning something else. That is, opportunities come, and if they're attractive, you take advantage of them. And there are some cases of people who have a vision at the beginning and stick to it. Maybe they're blessed. But for me, I was just trying to learn what law was about. And then when I got out of law school, I became a clerk in a federal court, and I learned what the courts were about. And then I started practicing law in the best firm I could do it. And one thing led to another. After 12 years of practicing law, I became a judge. After 12 years of being a judge, I left that and became a professor. So I've been in law practice, I've been in the judiciary, and I've been in the professorate, and it's all good. I mean, I really think that there's a lot of interesting stuff in law to do. I never had the passion to do one particular thing, to defend those accused of crime, or no particular passion. I just wanted to learn law, be a master of it, and do it. And I did it wherever the best opportunity came up for me. And I've loved it, and I think you made a very good choice. As Arthur said, it gives you a very broad array of possibilities for your future, including business, by the way.
What led you to leave the bench and become an academic? We heard Jodi left the NFL and became an academic. Yeah.
I was on a special court. It's the Delaware Court of Chancery, and it doesn't have a jury, and it has a broad but nevertheless limited jurisdiction. Its most famous part of jurisdiction is over corporations, Delaware corporations. So I saw a lot of M&A, a lot of fiduciary duty suits. I learned like crazy for the first 4 or 5 years. I was in over my head for the first 18 months. But I had mastered it, I thought, after about 6 years. Now, it's all good. It's all interesting. And the nice thing about being a judge is people bring you interesting problems every day. You don't have to go and search for them. They come to you. The lawyers brief them up. It's like a feast, if you like, deciding things. But after 12 years, I was far more successful at this job than I had reason to expect. And I thought I had done it. The question was, should I go on the Delaware Supreme Court? The Chief Justice job came open at some point. or should I try teaching? Because I had started teaching at Penn as an adjunct, and I liked that. So I decided 12 years of this was very good, 12 years of practicing law was very good. Maybe I'd do something else. So
what's your next act?
That's a good question. The time is close now. I have to start.
There's got to be a next act. You always have to believe there's a next act.
Yeah. My wife just had twins 6 months ago. So this reorients my professional thinking. I see these little
faces.
It's
funny the way you phrase that. Your wife had twins. You didn't have twins? You're free and clear.
I was in the room, but I didn't have...
You were in the room. now, Betty...
Yes.
He lasted 12 years. You lasted a hell of a lot longer as
Correct.
A judge.
Correct.
Don't mean last in any pejorative sense.
No, I understand that, Arthur. Well, let me say this. I was on the bench for 30 years, but actually 50. I'd like to step back a little. I decided I wanted to be a lawyer when I was 12 years old. Because my father talked to me about the labor movement, et cetera. I was going to be a labor lawyer. I single-handedly was going to save the labor movement. And also, I had another goal. I was going to be a United States senator. Well, life didn't quite fall into that pattern. Instead, I had the opportunity, after I graduated from law school, and you didn't ask me the question, what did I expect of law school? I must tell you, frankly, I never thought about it. All I knew was I had to get a degree in order to get out there and be this labor lawyer and whatever. Although I, in its own way, I enjoyed it very much. I get out of law school, and guess what? The labor movement was not waiting for me. I was 50 years too late. You know, I had this idealized version. Instead, I got a job with a maritime firm. Well, that was a lot of fun, representing plaintiffs. That's why I rose to that bait. I stayed a couple of years and had the opportunity to become a law clerk with a judge. Now, I said, oh, that would be okay for a couple of years, because I still was gonna try for that elective office, you know, route. Jonathan, I was ready to settle for the assembly, and I did vote for you, by the way. In any event, and this is my thinking, listen, a judge, you decide one case at a time. Now, you're a legislator, you make big decisions. Boy, was I wrong. And just look at what's going on in Washington today. In any event, I was with that judge for 20 years, and I was very fortunate. He really depended on me a great deal. He was a wonderful courtroom judge. Paper to pencil, that wasn't his thing. So I did, frankly, I wrote some of my best decisions under a pseudonym. And I realized I loved it.
I did the same thing, clerking.
Right? Right? he once said to me, you know that decision I wrote in someplace? So I looked at him, because we had a great relationship, so I said, who wrote? No one was around. In any event, then the opportunity arose for me to go on the bench. They have these screening panels in New York. Because I wasn't very politically active, I already had three children, I just didn't have that kind of time. But people knew me from my being in the system as a law clerk. I was the only woman, I was the first woman to ever be a law clerk to a regularly elected Supreme Court judge in the state of New York. That was in 1965. Think of it. Today, I would say there's an overwhelming number of women, and I think the profession has been greatly strengthened. In any event, I was first elected to the civil court. I never sat there for a day. They sent me to criminal. I didn't want to go, but I loved it when I got there. Then they sent me to take the city part. Then the chief judge made me the citywide administrator. That's the only job I didn't love, because I was dealing with Ed Koch, and I had to defend my judges. Then I went to heaven. That's called the appellate division. And I was there for over 20 years. I can't tell you how wonderful that is. Being a judge, you have an opportunity to really make a difference in people's lives. Now, unfortunately, the Constitution has this ridiculous provision in it that when you're 76, that's it. You've got to step down. So, I mean, hey, go fight the Constitution of the state of New York. So I had to retire, but I was not ready to retire. So now I'm with a wonderful law firm called Alston and Berg. Notwithstanding that they're a big law firm,
They represent wonderful clients, and I have found it very interesting and rewarding. I also do mediation and arbitration, very involved with bar associations. Somebody mentioned the bar associations. That's a great way to go. Whatever you get into, make sure you join the bar associations. That is really very uplifting, as well as being very helpful for your career.
And doing it as a young lawyer is
right.
Especially important. Because
absolutely. The people you meet, the vistas it opens up for you. And so let me conclude by saying, I'm making a heck of a lot of money, more than I did as a judge today. But if they said to me tomorrow, you can go back on the bench, no money in a minute. Because it is such a rewarding occupation. I really feel there were cases where I feel the result came out right because I was the judge. So think about that as you go along. And whatever area you go into, think about the possibility of ultimately ending up on the bench.
Now, Jason, you're our newbie. In terms of the law, you've got the least time in grade. So you can think most clearly about your time here. I'll ask you the question I started with at the beginning. When you came here as a student, what was in your head in terms of the rest of your life?
I was a former teacher, so I went to grad school, and I wanted to do ed policy and to get into government. I came in excited to relax. When I was an undergrad, I worked all the time. When I was teaching, I worked all the time. And I taught seventh graders, so it wasn't, it was no big thinking.
So what do you say to these people who think they're working very hard?
Nah. it's what I say all the time. Being a grown-up is highly overrated. Take your time, relax, enjoy Thursdays in the bar or wherever y'all go. But that's why I came. As a teacher, I had a lot of special needs students, and I found that a door would always open for an individual with a JD over a teacher, and I felt that, okay, I needed to have this to be able to advocate on behalf of my students. Got here, was a recipient of the Bar Association's First Year Fellow Program, and ended up at a firm. My mentor that summer told me, what's the worst that can happen? Take a chance, do a corporate deal. Fell in love with it and ended up practicing corporate law for 3 years at Kirkland and Ellis. It was a great opportunity, but it wasn't in my blood to practice or to do corporate law. About a year and a half ago, took a 99% pay cut to run a state Senate race in Maryland. And I realized how low I had fallen when I had talked to an elected delegate. He's like, oh man, my campaign manager was 19. I was 33. But it was something that I always wanted to do. I wanted to get involved with the political process. We were successful. We defeated a 27-year incumbent with a 27-year-old young man who's now a senator. Ran the election day campaign for the governor and senior senator of the state. So I got that out of my system, and then my wife told me I needed a real job, and so I ended up at the city. So
you're now a policy wonk.
I wouldn't say that. I would say that I'm a constituent servant.
Words, words, words. How long do you think you're going to be doing what you're doing?
Good question. I like what I do, but I don't see it as a terminal position for me.
Now, when you were here, what helped you here, if anything, in as you move forward?
I would say that I was as involved as possible as I could be. I think the best thing about the school here was that everybody got along. I'm a very clumsy person, and I broke my hand like October 20th of my first year, and I'm left-handed. So I couldn't type, I couldn't write. I was like, I'm screwed. And so, and finals were coming, and I was literally sitting in, I don't know if how many of y'all have Professor Barkow, but I was sitting in her class, and literally as class ended, I got like 6 emails of notes from my classmates. And folks were like, hey, if you need anything, let us know. And it was just the realization that, you know, it's not cutthroat, is that, you know, people realize that we're all going after something, we all are here for a reason, and it's not necessarily to step on each other to get to that place. And so I took that, you know, that is everybody here to never question a person's motives and their intent, and you have to, you know, believe that what they say is what they mean. So,
do you think you'll ever go back to a law firm?
Only in a very highly paid advisory position. I tend to believe that I can think big thoughts. Action may be another thing, but no. I am grateful, and one of the reasons why I did it was the fact that there were a dearth of African-American men. I was the most senior African-American man in my firm when I left, and I was a third year. And the partners called me in, please, you know, what can we do? We need you. You know, I replied that, no, the NAP form is due next week, so you have to figure out a way to put a black man in, put a one beside, you know, that box. But, you know, and it was a hard decision because, you know, you're faced with, if you leave, you know, your frustrations about what the law looks like, you know, somebody else will have because there's nobody else that they can look up to. But you have to balance that with what you have a passion to do, and to be someplace where you don't want to be simply because you feel like you have to be is miserable. And so I can affirmatively say that I won't be at a law firm practicing law. I will leave it open for lucrative offers that may come.
Now, Steve, you left this place and you didn't go to a law firm.
That's correct. Let me back up. So the year out of college, I worked as a copy boy at the New York Times. As editor of my college newspaper, I was long interested in journalism and in law. And in the year after I worked as a copy boy at the New York Times, you know, fetching coffee, and reporters would pull, you know, pieces of paper out of their typewriter and yell, copy, and you literally run and get that. I know
paper?
That sounds like in the primordial age. So after a year of that, I applied to NYU Law School and I applied to Columbia Journalism School. I was accepted at both, and I was torn. And I went to Columbia Journalism School, and after that, I worked for 3 years in Hackensack at the Bergen Record. And I was really unhappy there because, like many places in society, it was run by maniacs. And I said, this field, to quote my grandmother, was for cocta. And so I decided to go to law school, and I came to NYU. And I liked NYU very much, but while here, I had this like existential feeling that being a journalist at a good place, the creativity of writing and exploring what you want and researching stories is just more interesting than law. And for a guy with ADD, for people with ADD, journalism is a great field because you're doing one thing 1 minute and another thing another minute. And so after law school, I had an internship with Judge Robert Carter in the Southern District. And my first choice after the clerkship was a fellowship with the ACLU, and I was the runner-up. And if I had gotten that fellowship, I probably would be a lawyer today. But I also thought that if I could get a job with, I'm a Woodward and Bernstein Watergate baby. You know, I graduated college in 1973 when that was breaking. So I feel a lot of the idealism of journalism still. And I figured, well, I didn't get this wonderful job at the ASOU. If I can get a job with the New York Times or the Washington Post, why not? And I saw Sam S. Stryker upstairs at lunch, and Sam said, remember we had that lunch? And I said, you have 2 years, you could work at the Times, and if you feel that journalism's not right, you could always come back to the law. And Professor S. Stryker said, but if more than 2 years, forget about it. And life at the Times has been very good to me. I remember I served a year in New York and 3 years in Chicago and 5 years in Paris. And I remember I came back for my 10th law school reunion, and I had just gotten back from Paris, and all these classmates were so jealous of my job. I said, but you guys are all making three or four times as much as I am. And a fact that we use in our union contracts, at the New York, union disputes at the New York Times, is that many of the journalists at the New York Times, like me, who've been there 25, 28, 30 years, earn like $20,000 or $30,000 less than a first year at a large law firm. So it's not a lucrative profession. And Joe Lilleveld, the former executive, the wonderful former executive editor, said, and not to sound sexist, but it's like a brotherhood, a Catholic brotherhood where we're taking vows of poverty to pursue what really interests us. And one of the things that very much interested me in journalism over law is that you could really pursue what you're interested in a way. And I, what Betty said was very interesting. You do fascinating things as a judge, fascinating cases come to you. But one of, I think, the great things as a journalist is that if you're interested in this issue or that issue, or you see, quote, injustice, unquote, that you think is worth, brandishingly shining a lot spotlight on, you can do that. And I like to write also, and I often felt as a lawyer, you could not exercise that writing muscle the way you can as a journalist.
Mm. No poetic license in writing briefs.
I remember I was at Paul Weiss one summer. I spent half a summer with Staunton Lind, this former law professor, historian at Yale, who got fired for being too lefty, right? For being too outspoken in fighting the Vietnam War and going to North Vietnam. So I spent part of the summer out in Youngstown, Ohio, with Staunton Lind trying to fight to keep steel mills open. I spent the other half of the summer at Paul Weiss, so it was very schizoid. And I remember, Judith Thayer, who was kind of the head hiring partner, saying, your writing is very breezy. And I wasn't sure if that was an insult that it's lightweight or whether that was praise, meaning it's actually readable compared to everybody else.
Steven?
I've read briefs. I still read briefs. I wrote a story this morning on a legal complaint, not a brief. Some briefs are very nicely written, but rarely as well written as a well-written newspaper story.
But you're still using some legal skills in your reportorial
work. Yes and no.
Come on, admit it.
Come on. Let me.
What the hell would you know about labor and workplace if you didn't have a law background?
That's true. I know the interstices of labor law very well.
Interstices?
Just the word interstices.
Interstices.
Perfect.
Is that a New York Times word, or is that a word from a brief?
I think it's a Harvard Law School word. I could say intricacies.
Go ahead. You're acting as if I'm about to hit you.
We could say, continuing with the alliteration, we could say the intestines as well. Now I got lost where I was. I was talking about interstices. I got lost in the point.
Those analytical skills.
So after I finished law school and went to the New York Times, all these law professors said, well, law school must have really helped you because it taught you how to get to the essence of a problem and write about it. And I said, in my 3 years as a journalist before I came to law school, I learned as a journalist to focus on the essence of a problem and to state it clearly. And that helped me in law school. Mm-hmm. When I got out of NYU Law School, I was a business correspondent for a while. I wrote the business and the law column I shared that with Tamar Lewin for a while. I was always in the shadow of Linda Greenhouse, who, to whom I'm not related officially, but we both are grandfathers from Minsk in what is now Belarus, so maybe we're related. But you're right, Arthur, that there are fields like labor law, and I was writing a lot about antitrust when I was doing the business and the law column, where there was real substance I learned in law school that helped me on a lot of stories. But Steve, last point on this. Some people would say, going to law school didn't hurt your writing because the writing in law school is quite dry compared to journalistic writing or literary writing. And I think it did hurt a little bit.
But somehow you've survived.
What I was going to say, I have a current student whose her day job is an anchorwoman for a local news in Jersey.
I'm not as good looking as she is, I assure you.
And she is at law school because she wants to be a better journalist. She actually decided to go to law school not because she's going to change careers, but she thinks it will make her a better journalist to have the analytical skills and actually improve her communication skills. And I'm wondering what you think of that.
I don't doubt that it will improve her analytical skills, and if she does a very good job reciting in class, it might improve her skills in talking and analyzing. But do I think it's worth 3 years and how many, $150,000, so that she can go back and be an anchor with a little better skills in analyzing? I'm not so sure. But if she's really thinking of leaving journalism for another field, then it might be a wise decision.
I want to talk to Rocco. Rocco, you didn't take an oath of poverty.
I did not take an oath of poverty. I'm the a little bit of background. I'm the first generation son of Italian immigrants. So Italian was spoken in the home. I rebelled. I refused to speak Italian. I said, we have to assimilate. Let's all get
Mama
on with the program.
Mia.
We all got on with the program. And I had no idea regarding expectations. We didn't have an attorney in the family. We didn't know any attorneys. There was no internet, and there weren't 25 different legal shows about the law on TV like they are today. So I came into NYU at the time, and I just knew that I had a great con law class in college, and I said, this is interesting. They pay very well. My father was a laborer. He worked with his hands and with his body his entire life, and it was a very, very tough living. He did fine for an immigrant, but a very, very tough living. And I said, I know I don't want to do that. I want to do something else to use my brain. Came into NYU, and it's wow, the shock factor. Everybody is extremely smart. Bert Newborn in orientation got me through not only law school, but he got me through most of my career and some things he said. He said, everybody in this class at orientation, he said, everybody here has graduated in the top 10% of their undergraduate class. Get with it, only 10% of you will graduate in the top 10% of this class. Number one. Number two is what he said is, look, after your first job, nobody will ask you about your grades again. He gave me a little bit of perspective with my entire life. So I come out, and right away I took a job, I took a high-paying job at that time at a law firm, and I wanted to be the consummate litigator. I got a little bit of a taste of what it was like to be a litigator at a big firm, and where I wasn't litigating much, and I then gravitated to something which I think suited my personality better. I got into the corporate and securities area, and M&A was booming at that time. We're looking at the 82 period, 1982 to 86. And I was doing law, doing some really big deals, doing $1 billion deals when $1 billion meant a lot of money, not when we have lots of billionaires all over the place. $1 billion was a big deal at the time. And I would work on a deal, work with my clients, and at the end of the day, they would go home, and they wouldn't be around the weekend, and I would be there working through the night, I'd be there working every weekend, and I said, something's wrong. I think I'm a lot smarter than those people on the business side, and they have a much better lifestyle than myself, who's through the night papering the deal. And I said, they get to do a little bit more of the creative stuff. So I was still working at a big firm, and I had the JD from NYU, but I said, you know what? I'm gonna get an LLM from NYU, and I wanna position myself to see if I can move into one of the big investment banks. Did my 4 years at a big firm, and then I was able to work my way and get a job into, at that time, one of the predecessors of Lehman Brothers, and I got into and I was happy at the firm, at least in what I did, and respected, but I said, I think there's gotta be something else. Moved in-house, and worked in their corporate merchant banking group at the time, and had a great 3 years working now in entirely different role as an in-house attorney, and enjoyed it, enjoyed my evenings, enjoyed my going home at night and getting married and having my first child, made it a little bit more of a normal lifestyle. But my goal was then to say, how do I get into the business side and what do I do? Back after 3 years, I moved on to the business side. And I'll tell you, if you show what you can do and you can work with different groups there, a lot of people will come calling and say, what about the opportunity? You know, they'll just say, here's a great role for somebody with your analytical skill set. Why not join the business side? At that point, they didn't know. We were in a recession. It was a troubled economic time, reminiscent of what we're going through now. And I moved into an origination group that ended up being a restructuring and workout group. I was a corporate and M&A guy. I was not a bankruptcy creditors' rights guy, but I adopted a skill set and I rose up to run that group. And then at Lehman, for 22 years, I did lots of things on the business side, from the transactional side to then when I said I'd never done the capital market side, I moved into the fixed income division and I was gonna move it to prime broker, all these different opportunities from working at Lehman that was growing at the time. Move the story quickly, 22 years go by, and Lehman has a small problem in 2008 when it hits an iceberg. What do you do now? How do you reinvent yourself? I was 26 years out of law school. I had not been practicing law since 1989. Enjoyed lots of different hats that I wore at Lehman Brothers and lots of different roles. But what do you do when you're just turning 50 years old and, you know, and the world looks like it's collapsing, and what do you do? And I'll tell you, that's the great thing about being a lawyer and having that JD ticket. When you have great analytical skills, when you're able to write well, when you're able to speak well, when hopefully you develop some good leadership skills along the way, when you've networked the right way, when you answer those phone calls and those emails on the same day, you get to know a lot of different people. And then the opportunities became, was I going to practice law? Was I going to teach? I've been actively involved in the not-for-profit world, and I could have ran a not-for-profit. Or was I going to go at that point to the, what we call on Wall Street, I was on the sell side, was I going to move over to the buy side? And eventually it was a pretty good opportunity to move over to the hedge fund world. And I wanted to, I still like the financial services world, and I moved over to the hedge fund world. I want to make it clear though, all the jobs that I had and all the changes I did, I don't think it was any single one that I did because I was unhappy with what I was doing. An opportunity presented itself, it was doing something creative and different. And I tell my own kids, I said, look, get a law degree. I don't really mind, dad doesn't mind, we'll pay a lot of money, but dad and mom don't mind if you don't practice law. But it's gonna set you up for doing lots of great, wonderful things you do in life, and I'm not gonna be upset. You know, take the bar exam, get through that so you said you did it, and you got it done with it. But it will set you up to be so skilled, and in the business world, by having the legal skills, you're always utilizing them in the legal world. And there's so many people that I'm dealing with who are, let's say, ex-attorneys or people, or as I'm going through each day, the skill set that I have comes into play every day in what I do.
It's amazing that you're sitting next to Bill, who in his description of his journey, each of his law jobs was filled with excitement and invention. And he's not right, you're not right. You're not wrong, he's not wrong. One size doesn't fit all. You found a perfect niche for your personality.
So the only person who was wrong was Jodi, who left the NFL? That's the only person. She's the only one who made a mistake on the whole panel, right?
Arthur, can I make an observation, though? I think there's one thing, and I don't mean to be a downer, because this really isn't a downer, although it'll sound like it, but there's something that we are kind of skipping over that I hope is sort of obvious to everybody. I mean, most of the people on this panel are fairly far out of law school at this point. And so whether they became a judge or went into business or went into journalism or plaintiff's firm or defendant's firm or whatever, they've reached a point in their careers where they're fabulously happy, and in part because they're senior enough that they're now ordering other people around. They have 9,200 people working for them, and they're making big decisions, and they're being creative, and they've got this really great stuff going on. And that's in the future for everybody in this room, but it's not in your immediate future. I'm sorry to say that.
They have to get through civil procedure.
As the youngest one here, I can tell you. I'm just going to tell you, no matter what you go, I don't think I'll be contradicted if I say no matter what area you go into, the first few years, it's grunt work. No, and there's a lot of non-creative stuff.
I mean, for those of us who clerk the year after law school, I mean, it's
something that's that wonderful.
That's wonderful.
I mean, that's something you're 20, you know, as I was, if you're going right from college to law school, you're 25 years old, you're drafting an opinion as
the clerking's
way,
great.
Yeah, as the way Betty described it, you know, basically you're being the judge
right.
When you're writing these opinions. And that's something that, even if you never will be a litigator, I think it's something that there's nothing you could do that first year out of law school which would have more weight down the road, because once you write that opinion, that's always going to be part of the law for as long as time
it
exists.
So I think that,
and by the way,
unless he overturns it, it's reversed.
And if you're thinking of clerking, by the way, don't like look at judges and rank them. This is the most prestigious judge, second most prestigious judge, third most prestigious, because judges do use their clerks differently. Some judges let their law clerks sort of do first drafts of opinions. There is a very highly respected judge who's no longer on the bench, who was once quoted as saying that the most important thing his clerk does for him is fill his candy dish before argument. That's not the judge you want a clerk for. I don't care how well respected he is.
Okay, there are a couple of people who we have yet to hear from. Joe.
Yes.
You also left the law.
Yes, I have left the law. I'm now, I have an insurance brokerage business. So I've combined, although it's not quite as far from the law as it seems, insurance, like so many fields in our economy and our culture, has a legal element to it, a very strong one in the case of insurance. It essentially is all contracts. So having a contractual understanding, which my personal story, I actually, when I applied to law school, thought I wanted to be a litigator, thought I wanted to stand in the courtroom and said, I object. But as I approached law school, I got a job on Wall Street at James D. Wolfenson and found that I really liked that and tried that out my first summer after law school and found that it was great. So I went into M&A at a medium-sized firm that then merged with a big firm, which is probably something in some of your futures. Went into insurance brokerage and started doing this, which has a strong legal element, and then also even more, a lot of what I do is work with M&A transactions, with insurance, using them to bring people together to solve problems, to put things that are creating conflict between the two sides onto a third party, an insurance company. So that creativity, that vision still is with me, but I have moved away from the law.
Allison?
Well, I'm going to be in a very strange position of agreeing with Brad, and I say it's strange because at least 50% of my time was spent being a defense side attorney. So as a plea for collegiality, we can get along and agree. And the part I'm going to agree with is I was at a firm for 8 years, which was far, far, far longer than I intended to be there. I sort of said, I'm going to go for 2 years. That's, you know, I'm going to pay off some debt. I'm going to get myself set up. And then I'm going to go do something that actually is interesting. And the first 2 years were tough because it was not the reason I came to law school, which is I thought these are issues that are intellectually engaging and I want to do something productive and really shape big issues. The first 2 years
not
can
so
be,
much, right?
Yeah, not so much.
Document review, right?
Yeah, I can check boxes very well. I can tell you whether something is privileged or not privileged. It was tough, but something weird happened at around the 2 year mark. It got interesting, and suddenly new doors opened up, and practice became much more exciting. You find good mentors, you get to do a little bit more. And I was fortunate enough to be at a firm where 50% of the time I was maybe doing tort defense work primarily, but then another big chunk of my time was spent as a plaintiff's attorney. So maybe that's the part of me that agrees with you, working on a huge prisoner's rights class action. So one of the things that was great is wherever you are, you can kind of carve out what you want to do. So that's the other thing I would encourage you to think about, that even if you're going down, and I think unfortunately or fortunately, most of you are probably headed to OCI next year or have survived it this year and are going to start out at a firm. But that doesn't mean you have to be the stereotype of what a firm lawyer is. And now I'm back. So that's the other lesson from this. If you go to NYU Law School, you can come back to NYU Law School. I left practice in the spring, and I left practice to come back and being a be a lawyering professor here to some of the students who are in the class, some of whom are your students.
Don't blame me.
No. They say nothing but good things. And so now I'm back. And part of the reason I came back is as much as I enjoyed practice and as interesting as it was, when you're a litigator, there's only one way to see the world, and that's the way that's good for your client. So the way you write about issues and think about issues is all driven by your client's needs. But I was finding that there were other things that were sort of intellectually interesting to me about the disputes I was in, and I wanted to think about them as a whole instead of from one point.
All right, now we come to Linda, who does not look pleased. Linda, the group should understand, and I have known each other since before birth. Linda was my student. Linda was a research assistant of mine.
And it's all his fault.
And she has been saying that for about 45 years. Now, Linda, of this group up here, you're somewhat unique because you've led what some wag might call a very sedentary life. You have been on this faculty for 40 years. Aren't you bored?
Well, in some ways, my life has been a sort of failure as I listen to all of this. I mean, of course, the job I realized I wanted was Jodi's job, and I never got that job, but I didn't know it at the time, I think. In fact, I didn't want to be a lawyer at all. That's why I say it's been a failure.
At least I sent you to one Super Bowl, Linda, right?
That's right.
Linda was my civil procedure professor. And as a reward for making me into the proceduralist I am today, Linda went to a Super Bowl featuring her team, the Steelers.
There's too damn
on my tickets.
There's too damn much incest in this crowd. Go ahead.
But I wanted to be an actress, and I wanted to be a writer. And I realized I'm a realist, and I realized I had no talent. And so then the question was, what do I do? I mean, I'm an English major. I'm a drama major. I didn't want to wait tables. And I wasn't really very good. And so one summer while I was in college, I sat in a law school class, and I thought, you know, this is really fun, and the one thing this will enable me to do is I won't have to teach. And so I went to law school. I had no idea what I wanted to do. There was Perry Mason on television in my day, and I thought that might be fun. But really, I had no idea, except I knew that I didn't want to teach. And so it was really quite interesting because when Arthur interviewed me for a research job after my first year, he said to me, what do you want to do? And I said, I don't know. And he said to me, have you ever thought about teaching? And I said, oh my God, no. I mean, I came to law school so I wouldn't have to teach. And then I realized I was looking for a job with him, and this was probably not the right answer to somebody who is spending his life teaching. And I said, no, no, I'm sure teaching is a great thing for someone, just not for me. And he didn't hold it against me, and I worked for him, and I taught a class for him. At one point, and I went on my way. I had a Fulbright in England when I got off, which is another wonderful thing to do, probably even beats clerking. And I then went into a private law firm, and I was really, you know, quite happy there. I think if anything described my life, it's probably serendipity, because I was in a private firm, and I was taking depositions in Peoria, Illinois. I don't know if anybody's ever been to Peoria, but it was pretty clear that that was not the greatest life either. And so when NYU called up and said, would you like to come and interview for a teaching job, I thought, fine. But I hadn't really thought about teaching. I thought that that was something I didn't want to do. And this is really not a great story to tell when I tell you why I came. And the dean, I actually made another mistake in terms of the dean that hired me, because when he asked me why I decided to come, I have a tendency to tell the truth. And so I told him that they were tearing down my apartment in Chicago, and I took this as a sign. And for years when I was here and he was the dean, I mean, there was always this sense of, we have hired some wacky woman. But I guess if I had a message, it would be that things often turn out well. And although you might say that in some sense it's been the same job, in some sense over those 40 years, it's been very different jobs. I mean, I started out as a civil procedure teacher. I went off at some point to the Justice Department and did appellate litigation. I've done a lot of work for the State Department in terms of negotiations. And one of the nice things about this job, in the long time that I've been here, it's almost as if I've had many jobs. I've been advisors to government, I've been consultants for law firms, I've been an expert witness, and so it's really been fine. And the only regret I have is I am neither an actress nor did I have Jodi's job.
I want each of you, as long as time permits, to advise this group of what they might think of doing during their 3 years here that might enhance their future lives. What are the do's and don'ts of being a law student, for example? And I don't mean take this course or that course, although that may be part of it. How should they be spending this 3 years to maximize the future that lies in front of them? Annalisa?
If you're going into public interest law, do get to know LRAP people, and do not get into credit card debt.
That's it?
That's it. Other panelists to cover the other topic.
That's it. You have no advice for the other 2 years, 11 months, and 29 days?
I'm going to defer to my colleagues.
I would say try it. So I would say try it. Whatever it is, try it.
Credit card debt?
Not with that card.
What's the it?
Whatever it is you think you want to do. So as an example, my first year at NYU is a great program where you have public interest fellowships. You can do an international one or you can do a domestic one. I came to law school convinced I was going to be a great public international law attorney. You see how that worked out. But my first summer, part of the reason I am not a great public international law attorney right now, is my first summer I did a fellowship in India, which was at a human rights organization, and it was amazing. I learned a lot. The area was really interesting, but I also learned it maybe wasn't 100% for me. There were some parts about it I loved, but being far away from my family, maintaining those kinds of relationships, the type of work I was doing, I found, while fascinating, wasn't really suited to my personality. And I would have never known that if I tried, and it was still a great experience.
There's been a sort of recurrent theme through the session, which almost can be summed up as know thyself. Where your heart is, where your feelings are, where your skills are. And you just sort of said it. It wasn't really me.
Right.
Because most of us don't know who we are.
And that's why you gotta try it.
You're now giving me advice?
The generic you.
I figure at this point, I'll never figure out who the hell I am. Now, Jodi, you're particularly interesting here. Throughout your career, you've had a family.
Yes.
Of some dimension. I mean, not just a boyfriend or something like that. You've really had a family.
Yes. I just want to say for a minute, if you're asking for one piece of advice, what to spend your time on in law school, I would have to say be on law review, and I am not talking about the journal. I was not on law review, but the man who eventually became my husband was. He wrote the scripts, he directed the music, we made the best friends of our lives amongst the cast and crew of Law Review, and it convinced him the day after law school, basically, he was not going to be a lawyer. He went into the entertainment business, he started his own record label, he's been phenomenally successful, and that actually partly answers your question,
Arthur. I thought
you
were making a suggestion about dating or something.
No, I'm making a suggestion about how you spend your time in law school.
And they sat next to each other in my civil procedure. Yes.
Wow. That is true. And you made a lot of hay out of that, I remember, one day in civil procedure. But so the answer to your question, though, is how was I able to start having kids almost immediately after law school and maintain a career all the way throughout? Raising children is because of the man I married, I have to admit. Just was
you mean big... that in that he facilitated, he enabled?
Absolutely.
That's a new job description. Now, what about in law school? How again, as Annalisa did and as Allison did, a jewel, a gem, a pearl of wisdom as to the next 2 2/3 years that lie in front of them.
Well, I said facetiously be on Law Review, but what I was really talking about is become part of this community, make friends with the people around you, reach out to everybody in every context. These are the people who will be a part of your career for much longer than the 3 years of law school. On every level, not only the really great friends we made hanging out with the cast and crew of the Law Review, but the people who you will go to because you need a lawyer or a client of yours needs a lawyer and your firm can't take on the job for one reason or another, or people who will come to you will be, it's about friendship, but it's frankly also about business development and spend your time getting to know your classmates.
Get uncomfortable.
You agree with that, Jason?
Yeah, I mean, mine would say be uncomfortable.
Be uncomfortable.
And get uncomfortable and do things you would not normally do.
You're a masochist. No, you're really a sadist. Go ahead.
I grew up on a farm, and the two places I said I would never go were L.A. and New York. I was in L.A. immediately preceded. Well, I moved to New York immediately preceded with being in L.A. And my parents would call, are you okay? Is everything all right? You know, and I'm a big dude, so, you know. But it was one of those things where it took me out of my comfort zone. And I mean, I honestly believe that I was in class and graduated with future leaders of our country in some way. And I felt that over these 3 years, I'm damn sure gonna make sure I know them. So if I need a job sometime, if I need some money, if whatever, they would know who I was and that I went to school with them. I mean, and that was something that I took advantage of, and I would say is like take classes that you think that you have no interest in whatsoever. And maybe take them pass fail so you don't have to really, you know, care. but I mean, I would literally say that this is the time when you find yourself. I think everybody here, even though we've taken all different types of routes to where we are now, we had a moment in law school where we found something out about ourselves, and it was in different ways. And this is what this time is about. I mean, I know y'all got a lot on your mind, but always keep that in mind that, that's what this is about, is to find out what you will end up doing and, what you want to do for your career.
And if you break your hand, you need to have people to take notes.
Yeah.
Right. In terms of know thyself, I think at law school, a lot of us at times, we'll just concentrate on, getting through this torts exam or writing this brief. I think it's really important to try to look ahead 10 or 20 years to what do I want to do with my life? Don't just look 3 years ahead. So if you want to be a human rights lawyer, maybe do what Allison did and, get a summer internship in India, and maybe, you'll experience some discomfort, and you might say that's for me, you might say that's not for me. If you want to, go into, become a business lawyer, corporate lawyer, you probably want to take more tax courses perhaps, more corporate law courses. I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. I think what Brad said is very wise. Your first 2 years out of here, it's in ways gonna be like an internship. You're gonna do a lot of hard, grunt work, you know, really learning how to write a brief, whether you're at a corporate firm or at Bronx Legal Services. But after 2 years, a lot of opportunities open up, and you'll realize as a lawyer, you have a real skill set that is very desired. This is quite a good law school, and with the skill sets and with your intelligence, you'll see many opportunities open to you, but you have to decide what opportunities you want.
Don't worry so much. Anything about these stories is that you are going to get a skill set, which I agree with. But don't worry about whether you've taken X course so that it'll enable you to do things, because things change.
Never take a course because you think it's going to help on the bar exam. Right. You'll learn what you need for the bar exam.
You'll learn
2 months before the bar exam.
And you'll develop different things, and your experiences will change you and mold you. And as you look down the road of people who've been out, you see they started out to be X and they've turned out to be Y. And more than likely, there'll be some of you who know what you want to do and you will be that person. Well, but for many of you, that will not be true, and you will have a set of skills and talents and background. And I just say, don't fret. That you don't know where you're going now. You've got, believe me, a very long time ahead of you, and maybe many different jobs and roles as you grow older.
Don't be a prisoner to your preconceived. You think you want to be a prosecutor. You think you want to go to corporate law. Explore every possible avenue. You may find, and you've heard here how we've all had different kinds of routes. That's what you really should be doing in law school. Yes, you may want to be a prosecutor or a defense lawyer, but don't be a prisoner to that. Except really, along with what Linda said, look at every discipline with an open mind. Gee, this might be interesting. And if there are opportunities, extracurricular, so to speak, take them. What do you have, all of these possible areas where you can go into court, what do you call those? I've been away so long.
The clinics,
thank you. Yeah, the clinics, get involved in them. And I have one final word. Linda, it is not too late to get at the theater. The Bar Association has a wonderful entertainment committee. We put on shows that are reviewed. So I'm gonna sign there.
What I was Linda, looking at Broadway, but what, no.
Linda, I got a review.
Linda was not being honest.
Yes.
What Linda really wants, and Linda has wanted since the day I met her,
yes,
was to be the Pittsburgh Steeler running back. That's what she really wants. All right, it's time for some of you to go to class. This has been a wonderful assortment Silverman, of people. Yeah.
I love that one.
So,